This is Neal Morse. Welcome to the first edition of Musicians. Woo! Musicians having coffee and talking about stuff.
Woo!
Yes,
yeah, okay.
Actually,
I got my flying colors, man.
I realized I should have picked a better mug. I didn't give any thought to the mug. I should have.
You disgust me.
It was a Beatles mug, but as you can see, it's very, very faded from all the coffee I drink.
Yes.
I have a great yellow submarine mug that it's an empty yellow submarine when the mug is empty. Huh. But as soon as you pour hot coffee in it, the four faces appear.
You showed me that. I've seen it.
Yeah.
That is so cool.
I
understand that, but you like the Beatles? Is this news? Is this a thing?
You know damn well, Morse, because I kicked your butt twice.
Never. I demand a rematch. What about that little girl of yours?
Ooh.
What in the world?
Yeah, actually, now that you mention it, that was last Christmas, and here we are. We got Christmas coming up in a couple of days, so I'm going to demand a rematch with her on Christmas Day.
If I were you, I'd be scared. It isn't that I don't know the songs. It's the synapses in my brain do not work like the Portnoys, man.
Oh, come on. You were head to head with me the whole time.
Oh, you're being kind.
I'm just only slightly sicker than you, but you're just as sick.
Well, no, I have to kind of hum through the tune. I told you about how not too long after we did our last one, I was on a cruise and they did a Beatles Name That Tune. And it was hilarious. It was so great. Like they play like Come Together. And and I would just lay out. I'm like, well, I'm not going to guess it. I mean, you know, they play the whole thing and nobody would get it till they came to the chorus. Come Together. And somebody says, oh, Come Together. That's right.
They must have at least got She Loves You because it opens with the title and the right. chorus on the downbeat.
It was so easy. There was only one that was even remotely obscure. It was the anti Portnoy is what it was. That was funny. So how you doing, man?
I'm doing good. We are well, thank you for having me on this. You know, obviously you and I talk constantly. I've heard every one of your stories 100 times each. So now you get a chance to hear a couple of mine.
I'll let you get a word in. You know, we Americans are. We talk so much. Nobody can talk.
Yes, I mean, this is true.
Actually, well, that is true. At my family dinner table, sometimes I'm like, hey, can we need like a talking stick, you know, because everybody's just like, has so much to say, you know, until you mention Jesus and then it gets really quiet. No, I'm totally kidding.
Actually, Christmas is for me, and we were just discussing this, me and Marlene and the kids, that Christmas Eve, what we do, we get together at my mother-in-law's on Christmas Eve, and then we do Christmas Day at my house. But Christmas Eve is when the family exchange gifts to everybody.
Yeah.
It is complete chaos and out of control. And we were just saying how we need something like what you said, like a stick or whatever, that you take turns. Like, literally, everybody's just opening up presents at the same time. Nobody's watching what everybody else is getting.
Yeah.
And it's complete chaos. And you spend all this time shopping for the perfect gift, and you want it. And it just goes by in a blink of an eye, completely unappreciated, because it's just such chaos.
Yeah. Yeah. And I've suggested that we do them one at a time, but that might take like actually a couple days to do.
Totally.
I mean, Sherry does like all these intricate little things for the stockings, and right. I mean, it's pretty insane.
Oh, I can imagine Christmas at your house is pretty pretty festive.
In fact, I just wrote this song called Mrs. Claus on the Christmas album for her. And the original lyric was buying too many gifts for Christmas morning.
Right.
But I decided I would, you know, buying our favorite gifts. Let's make it a little, let's keep it positive, Mike.
Right. Did you guys do shopping? Marlene does. The only reason I ever got married is so somebody could do all the Christmas shopping, you know. That's the greatest thing ever when you have a wife that's like that. So basically, you only have to buy her gift, and she buys everybody else's. But everything this year has been online.
You have to buy her a gift?
Well, to be honest, actually, the last couple of years, we've actually changed it up where we don't get each other gifts. We decide something, a big gift we want to treat ourselves for the house, a big project or a big, you know, something expensive.
Mm-hmm. Hey,
out,
you stuck for a second there.
Yeah, you did too, but we're good, right?
Yeah,
But anyway, so now we just basically decide one big gift we buy ourselves, treat ourselves each year.
Yeah, we're kind of doing that too.
Yeah. But everything this year, she's done all her shopping online. We have like 10 Amazon gifts, 10 Amazon deliveries every single day this month. It's crazy.
Yeah, yeah. Same here, pretty much. Yeah, Christmas. Wow. I guess I didn't need this list of things to talk about. I made a list of things, and I sent it to you by accident, which I thought was
And I didn't look at it, because I don't like knowing questions in advance. Well, I like just
some of these just came to my mind, like, as I was just, you know, going for a walk in the morning or something like that. And some of them, it makes me wonder, what did I think we could actually talk about? Like, how much was there to say? How much is there to say about the McRib, for example?
Oh, man, you can go on for hours about the McRib. You could have your own McRib podcast.
They probably do, right? Yeah. Somebody probably does.
Well, here's the beauty thing about the McRib. First of all, it's absolutely awful,
right?
But it's so awesome. But I mean, it tastes delicious, but it's so bad for you. But the thing about the McRib is that it only comes around every couple of years, and I think the last it's kind of like a comet sighting. You know, it comes around like every 8 years or whatever. Right. And the last time the McRib came around was when we were at your place doing, I think the first or second Flying Colors album, because I remember Bill Evans was with us, and he made such a big deal about the big deal I made about the McRib. So this I think is that's the last time.
Mike, this is what I'm talking about. See, there is a lot to say about the McRib.
There is. And they actually had a thing where they had McRib finders and websites specifically to track certain, you know, where it was specifically popping up, and you had to like find the location and go to it. But so you know, the return this month was really a glorious achievement in this horrible year 2020.
Glorious achievement.
One of the few good things.
Achievement. I like that choice of word.
Well, it was a big deal in 2020. You know, it's been a horrible year, but at least the McRib came back for a few weeks.
Well, it's amusing to me for a lot of reasons. We both really like them. How do you know it's unhealthy? We don't really know what it is. We don't know what's in it.
Well, to me, it's all about the bun, the sauce, the pickles, and the onions. The actual rib itself is kind of
the mystery meat, right? Could be anything, actually.
Yeah, total mystery meat, actually. Right.
Go ahead.
Well, I think one of the big things of your podcast should be food, because people probably don't realize how much of a foodie you are. Uh-huh. And I've probably eaten about 5,000 meals by your side, you know, whether it be at your house or on tour or sitting in a dressing room or catering in a, you know, we've eaten a lot of meals together, and I'm usually sitting right to your right. I don't know why that works out that way, but you enjoy your food. You really do.
I do. That's true.
You actually, the whole time you're eating, you're like, making comment. You're like, you get into it.
Food kind of blows my mind. Like when I'm eating something and it's like so good, you're just like, how is this happening? Like every bite's like a miracle. You know, but
the convergence of flavors is
back to the mind of Mike Portnoy.
Like, okay,
the mind of Mike Portnoy. Who is going to remember that? Oh yeah, McRib happened at this time when we were doing this session. It's like, what? This is what I'm talking about. You know, people ask me all these kinds of questions in interviews, and I'm like, oh, you're gonna have to ask Mike. I don't remember any of that stuff. You know,
it's funny. I did it's holiday season. I just got blasted with cameo requests, so I did about 50 of them yesterday. And one of them was a cameo for a guy. He said, "Okay, it was December 2nd, 2012. I was at your show in Torrance, California, and I got ejected for getting up and getting loud and rowdy and telling everybody to get up or whatever. And I looked at the date and everything, and I knew exactly what show it was. I knew it was Flying Colors, the very first show we ever played in Torrance, California.
Ejected?
But I was able, just from the date and location, to know what gig, what band.
Yeah.
I apologized to him that you know, the Prague concerts are so formal and polite.
He must have been pretty wild to get ejected. I mean, that's quite a word. That's like a James Bond word.
Well, they had a button on his seat, and they hit the button, and it flies through the roof.
Yeah.
That had to have been a Cal Prague, one of those Papa Jim shows or something. And, of course, those are a lot more formal, and, you know, people sit and politely watch. Well, this guy must have been, like,
As long as they're awake.
Right. Well, we've had a few where they aren't, believe me. Right. And they're always directly sitting in front of Eric Gillette.
Right, that's right. He was starting to get a complex.
Yeah, but totally.
I don't know if it was the tour or the tour before that. It's like every night there's some dude asleep right in front of me. I can't take it. I can't take it anymore.
As always, at the most glorious moment, too, at the end of the album where he's just going for it. And nothing more inspiring than people in the front row sleeping.
This is why prog festivals, especially indoor prog festivals, I say generally do not work. Because
it's true.
It's so much music to listen to and it all day long, right? And then a lot of the audience is older. Right. So
right.
If we go on at 11, I mean, I'm asleep by 9 most of the time.
Right. And like you said, these people are enduring music all day long of, you know, 20 minute songs, every single song. So, yeah, it's definitely an endurance test.
Yeah,
it's an endurance test enough just to see one of our concerts, but to go through a few day festival where it's just band after band after band.
My favorite thing is a lot of times the promoter, of course, is a huge fan. So the whole time they're telling you, oh, we're so glad you're here. We're so into it. It's so amazing. And then as soon as we hit the stage, you see him right in the front.
And it's usually and our wives are pretty much the same, too. I remember.
They won't even show up.
Well, I think the last time Marlene saw Transatlantic was the Whirlwind Tour, where we were playing the whole Whirlwind for the first set. And then the second set was made up of, I think, 3 half-hour songs, All the Above, Stranger in Your Soul, Do with the Devil. So
of course,
the whole show was like 3.5 hours.
I remember the exact set list. Of course, you don't. Yeah, I'm kidding.
Well, it was an easy set. It was a 3.5-hour show of only 6 songs. So
right.
Actually, it's not a hard set list to remember. But I remember Marlene, we finished the Whirlwind. And for most people, you know, most wives, that would have been, okay, we're done. We're out of here. No, that's just intermission.
Oh, yeah. I overheard you guys going into the dressing room. Mike, are you kidding? It's so long. Oh, my God, she said. I love Marlene's responses to things. And
yeah.
The Prague Christmas album, right? You guys were trimming the tree. You had the
totally
Prague Christmas album. Mike, oh my God, turn it off.
Exactly. Like the Prague Christmas album we did. It's like every song starts nice. You have your jingle bells and this is that song and this. And then all of a sudden it just goes off on these tangents of fiddlies and Prague bits. And
yeah.
And every time I have to throw that in the mix in the Christmas music, Marlene's like, turn it off, turn it off.
Right.
She's not a Prague wife.
Right. Yeah, my wife isn't either. But speaking of Transatlantic at the TLA, that's actually on my list because...
Oh, really?
Do you remember that somebody took your family's seats?
No, that was... wasn't that Transatlantic
it was
in
both.
New York City?
It was New York City.
Oh, both.
And it was this one, too.
Okay.
This was a different year.
TLA would have been probably Whirlwind.
Yeah.
The New York show, the famous New York show was the first tour.
Right. Yeah. Well, after Morse Fest this year, I was hanging around with some guys and we were having dinner actually. And the guy said, hey, I have a confession to make.
I guess where you're going with this.
Yeah. He said, cause he watched the DVD and he was like, oh man. Him and his father-in-law and I guess his mom were upstairs, and he totally threw his father-in-law under the bus. He was like, and my father-in-law just moved the tape and sat there and said, well, we'll see if they say anything. And the waitress came up and said something to him, and they just went, oh, no, like, you know, just...
Well, you should probably tell the story for the people watching that don't know the story.
Yeah, go ahead.
Should I tell it or you tell it? I don't remember. I think basically I asked the tour manager... It was a hometown show, and anytime we play hometown, you want to kind of reserve an area for your family. So I guess I had Marlene and maybe the kids or some friends coming out, and I asked the tour manager to rope off a section or tape it down, and then sure enough, come showtime, the family goes there, and there's fans, you know, just general public sitting in those seats.
The funny one was in New York.
Right.
Because the guy that was our tour manager that year... every day or every gig, there was some major faux pas. I think when we played TLA that year, he left the intro tape running. So it was still doing that.
For minutes into the show.
Intro noise minutes into the show. And then, you know, later on, he got in a car accident in the rental van. But there was just a lot of things. And so I remember you coming to me kind of going, man, this guy, just keep me away from him. One of those kinds of things. Just keep me away from him. He said, okay, Mike says to him, okay, you have one chance to redeem yourself. This is your chance to redeem yourself. See this table right here, right in the center? You know, my dad is coming. My family's coming. It's a very big deal.
My dad flew in from California for the show.
Right. I didn't know that part.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Wow. Anyway, so I had a real hard time getting there. I was staying with my family. I was at a hotel in Times Square, and I thought, oh, I'll just grab a cab. Like, we had sound checked earlier, way early, and the gig was at like 11:15 or something, you know, New York, right? So I remember not being able to get a cab in Times Square and running down the street just like, like I was going to miss the gig. And I had
would have started without you.
And I had a cassette tape with my vocal warm up. So I'm going, nyan, 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 yeah. So I finally get there. It's like 10 minutes before the show. And I walk in and I notice that I don't think that's Mike's family at that table. Right. So I walk up to Evan, to the tour manager, and I say, well, you know, what happened? What, that was for Mike's family. And this is what he said. I swear to God. He said, well, the people sat down there. What was I supposed to do?
Wow. And of course, it's the classic Seinfeld line.
Right.
Anybody can make a reservation. It's all about, what is it? Holding the reservation.
Keeping the reservation. Yeah. Yeah.
Anybody could, you know, reserve a table. The whole trick is, you know, actually reserving the table, keeping the reservation.
Right. Actually, Jerry Seinfeld was one of my inspirations for doing this, because I was just in Colorado, and Brandon, my son-in-law, is really into that Jerry Seinfeld Comedians in Cars Having Coffee show. And so we watched several of them, and the second one with Alec Baldwin is just hilarious, man.
Oh, they're all great.
And so I thought, that'd be fun, just like talk, just the you know, I people have asked me about doing podcasts and things, and I'd been like, I don't know, I'm not that into it, you know, and it seems like I didn't want to like prepare a bunch of stuff. But I mean, if we can just like talk and have a good time and people enjoy that, that'd be great.
Absolutely. So his is Comedians in Cars Drinking Coffee. Is this Musicians on Zoom Drinking Coffee? Do you have a title for this?
Musicians. What did I say? I said it already. Musicians Having Coffee Talking About Stuff.
There you go.
Because I want it to be, I don't want to just talk about music stuff or,
right.
You know, I mean, like, you know, I wanted to ask you about like, what was it like growing up, and what were things like in junior high school and stuff like that. Right. I don't know. You know?
Okay.
So what were things like in junior high school, Mike?
Junior high school, I was, oh God, I could probably get my junior high school yearbook if you go on hold for 1 second.
Well, I'm an American, so I can just fill the space.
Yeah. Give me 1 second. I get my junior high yearbook.
While Mike does that, I will continue to peruse my list. I have on the list, remember that dude who took your family seats?
Now, how bad is this to show how ridiculously organized I am that within 20 seconds I can find my junior high school yearbook?
That is insane.
How much does that say?
Yeah, it would probably take me weeks if I could ever. But I'm more like I'll never find it sort of guy.
No, I literally know where everything is. Here's my jean jacket in junior high school. That's me right there. Man. And the back of my jacket with Led Zeppelin and The Who, Rocky Horror and the Beatles, Pink Floyd.
You know, so the Stones, man? I saw the Stones on there.
Yeah. So I was already a rocker and a big music fan. And but let me find my picture here. But yeah, I was just starting to play drums, but I wasn't very serious.
Oh, really?
This is my junior high school picture. I'm wearing a John Lennon shirt.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow. You look like Max, man, or Max looks like you, I think.
Totally. But I think I won like friendliest person, you know, in the end of year polls too. I won friendliest or something like that.
Really? Well, wouldn't that change?
But yeah, I mean, I was, you know, into all those bands. I was into The Who and The Beatles and The Stones. And I was also into like the Sex Pistols and The Clash and The Ramones and Kiss. I wasn't really a Prague guy yet. I hadn't discovered Prague. I didn't discover Prague until high school. So my junior high school years, I was still more classic rock.
Right. Well, you're younger than me. So
yeah, I was born in 67. So
right. Yeah. So by the time you're in junior high school, it's late 70s, early 80s, right?
Yeah, early 80s. Yeah. 81, 82.
Yeah. So Prague is not, you know, I think the best Prague albums were all made between like 70 and 75, don't you?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So
I wouldn't even go to 75. I would say
74.
The magic years are, yeah, right to about 74.
Yeah.
I think, you know, obviously the ELP, they all kind of had their classic trilogies. Yes had, Yes album, Fragile, Close to the Edge.
Right.
Genesis had, I would say like Foxtrot, you know, maybe Foxtrot, Selling England, The Lamb. Mm-hmm. ELP had, you know, what, Trilogy, and what were their big three around that period?
Tarkus, Trilogy, and well, Brain Salad Surgery, and then there's...
Brain Salad. So yeah. So I would say that those
were
the years...
I'm a big Pictures in Exhibition fan. That's a little earlier, but yeah.
But I would say around 75 is when they all started to fall off and get a little too crazy. You know, Yes did Topographics, and ELP, when they do Love Beach, and, you know...
I think
Yes
Love Beach was quite a bit later. They probably did Works around that time, I'm thinking. I don't know. I'd have to...
Right.
I'm surprised you don't know all the dates.
I know them. I do know them. I think... well, the Genesis stuff, I mean, that was after Gabriel left, but those first couple albums without Gabriel, when Hackett was still in the band, like Trick of the Tail and...
Hackett.
Yeah.
Steve Hackett.
I think Trick of the Tail is... A great one.
Oh yeah, Trick of the Tail. I was gonna say that too. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, that was when all the. I wonder why that is. I was Sherry and I were talking about this last night because we watched that Bee Gees documentary.
Oh, and, so good.
We were talking about like why is it that there's these kind of big moves of a type of music. You know, and she was saying it was just, you know, that it's just kind of style and fads and things like that. And I think it's partly that, but it's partly there just happens to be a bunch of people, you know, doing the same kind of work really well for a season. You know, the British Invasion and the Prague thing, and then the, you know, really the disco thing. I mean, it's not my kind of music. I'm, you know, I'm not a dancer, Mike, and I think you can probably... vouch for that. but you know, it was kind of like how they were doing some really, you know, pretty quality songwriting, and then there came the backlash, and but that guy mentioned in the documentary that, well, then, you know, all these people started doing all this jumping on the bandwagon, doing all these really stupid disco songs,
right?
You know, whereas you know, arguably some of the Bee Gees stuff had a little more quality. But I've always thought it was really interesting. Like, why is it that at certain times, you know, in, I don't know, at certain periods of time, like in Germany, all these killer composers are writing classical music.
Right.
You know, and it's pretty amazing.
I don't think we don't see musical shifts and explosions like that anymore. I don't think you can't really look at, you know, the 2010s and see, well, this was, you know, it wasn't like a Prague explosion or a disco explosion. I think, you know, in the 60s and 70s, pop music or rock music was still very new, you know. So I think you could have these big explosions. You know, the Beatles came on the scene, had a huge impact. And then, you know, what the Bee Gees did in the 70s, or the punk movement with, you know, Ramones and the Clash and the Sex Pistols.
Yeah.
Or, you know, the Prague movement. So I think because music was still developing so rapidly back then, you could have movements a lot. You know, when was the last time a band made a splash like that in modern times? There's very few I could think of, you know, really.
Yeah, I don't know why it is, really. You know, I don't know if it's because of the whole paradigm shift of business, or, you know, I don't know why that is. I mean, it's pretty interesting. There's a lot of examples of it in history, in literature. You know, there you have, like, all these great writers in the early 30s, all in Paris, you know, Hemingway and all these other guys are all, like, cohorts, you know, and you're like, wow, that's amazing.
Right.
You know?
Same in film, like in the 70s when, like, you know, Francis Ford Coppola, Steven Spielberg, you know, Brian De Palma, George Lucas, they were all coming up at the same time. Martin Scorsese.
Right.
You know, you had this big movement, Robert Altman, Hal Ashby, all these kind of mavericks. And A lot of it's culture and you know, the late 60s and 70s had such a culture shift, you know, and but, you know, I guess in modern times, in terms of music and literature and film, you don't really see much of that these days. I guess, I don't know, maybe for music, it's possibly because there's so little, help from the mainstream, you know, Rolling Stone magazine or MTV or the Grammys, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. They're all so out of touch with modern music. They kind of all just are vehicles for pop artists or rap hip hop artists. And a lot of bands don't even get any recognition from any of those areas anymore, where they even exist. MTV doesn't even exist anymore. But, you know, the point is they may champion like a Foo Fighters or something like that. But beyond that, it's very hard for rock musicians or, you know, you forget about the various branches of rock, you know, whether it be metal or prog or anything like that, forget it. You know, we're just completely in our own little bubble at this point.
Yeah. And it's hard to know, like, if you and I had been working and doing what we're doing, what we've done in the last 15 years, if we had done that work, you know, in the early 70s, so, right. You know, if you could have transported us or what, you know, it's hard to know if it would have been, you know, a different path, or, you know, if it would have been more popular, or
it would have been one of two things. We either would have been completely buried and unnoticed, because back then, unless you get your record deal and with a big, big backing and you get Rolling Stone behind you, you know, unless you had that was your only vehicle to explosion.
Right.
But once you did, you were, you know, back then the phrase I love is, back then, you know, you had thousands of bands or artists selling millions of records. Now you got millions of bands or artists selling thousands of records.
And right.
So we would have either been huge, huge multi-platinum arena stars, or we would have been completely, you know, done and buried and starving and completely unnoticed.
Well, one thing was, we would have had to have been younger. I don't think ever major labels would ever be signing guy. I mean,
right.
How old was I when we did the first Transatlantic? I was 40. You know, yeah. It's like unlikely that, you know, a major label would pick
exactly
up a band of guys. You know, you were what, 32? 30?
I think I'm 5 years younger than you. So I was my mid-30s or early 30s. I can't remember exactly. But yeah, I mean, that's a great point. I mean, you didn't even, your prog career, you know, starting with Spock's Beard the Light, how old were you? I mean, that was the start of your prog career, and you were in your mid-30s, I assume.
Yeah,
right?
35 when it started, yeah.
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 That's a good point.
Well, it's because I was trying to get a deal as a singer-songwriter all through the 80s. You, in my 20s, when I was really going, I just didn't see... Yeah, I remember sometimes running into other musicians and them saying something like, well, we're going to do an independent deal with this company in Belgium or something like that. And I thought, man, how sad, those losers, you know?
Right.
You know, it wasn't until I died to all of that I started to write prog.
Right.
You know, I had to die to all the whole the whole business, really.
It was backwards for you, because most people will start with writing progressive music and the stuff that comes from their heart that they want to do, and then eventually have to fall back on something more commercial. You kind of went the opposite.
Well, I wouldn't say that what I was doing in my 20s, it wasn't from the heart. It was just more like, you know, the singer-songwriter side of me. But
you
went
from more commercial to more progressive. It usually, in a lot of times, goes the other way.
Oh, it's hilarious. Like, my album Life and Times is... You know, in a worldly sense of where we are in the world.
In a world.
It is, did I have enough sex in my voice when I said that? you'd think that would be a commercial album, or, you know, things that I do that are commercial, actually, you know, they sell in the hundreds, Mike.
Right.
You know? So it's really funny. So when I do a commercial album, it's only because... it's just in me and it's got to come out and I just want to see it happen and I'm just feeling those songs. But oddly enough, like, you know, I could probably get with someone, I don't know, like, you know, Robert Fripp, if he was still active or something like that. And, you know, Neal Morse and this guy make a record. We could set a tape loop up and just loop it. Just leave the room, right? Make a Frippin' Eno album, and and it would probably sell like, you know, 20 times the amount that my like regular song albums sell.
Hilarious.
Well, because
you know what? Thank God we made our mark in our, we have our niche and we have our audience, and thank God for that.
Oh, yeah, well, absolutely. Because those people, you know, their hearts are totally in the right place. You know, it's not a fashion show. It's the God, thank God. God knows, my wife would say. that's a jab at me, not anyone else. But yeah, thank God that they really care about the music, and they're very dedicated, and it's a very heartfelt thing. I'm really thankful for all of that. It's just kind of a funny upside down kind of thing.
Totally. But hey, you know, like you said, thank God for our audience, because they allow us to, you know, we get a lot of credit, you and I, for how busy we are and how much, you know, how prolific or how, you know, creative we are, just putting out multiple albums per year. But the reality is, if we didn't have somebody listening to it and an audience helping support and allowing us to do this, we wouldn't be able to, you know, work as much as we do and do as much as we do. So thank God we do have an audience like that.
You know? Oh, yeah, absolutely. I've been thinking a lot about that lately, how you'd have to have an outlet. If you don't have an outlet, I mean, you'd be like a chef that's just cooking. And if all the food just sat there and rotted, after a while, you'd quit cooking.
Right.
You know? I mean...
Well, that's to me, the scary part of what's going on with Spotify and music today. The fact
that... Oh, are we going there?
Well I don't want to... This isn't to bash on Spotify, but...
Go ahead,
to your
man.
Point,
whatever
but to your point of you know, if there's not an audience for it, why do it? It's scary to think of how many young up and coming musicians, 16-year-olds, 18-year-olds, 21-year-olds that want to do this for a living, and there's no way they're going to be able to do this for a living, because at this point in 2020, you can't make money off of your music. So how scary is that there might be these incredibly talented, prolific, game changing artists,
yes,
that we'll never hear because they at some point just get discouraged because they can't make a living and provide for themselves and their family out of making music, and then they just give up and walk away. And how horrible is that? That is absolutely horrible.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, sad to think of the bands and the artists in the coming 10, 20 years that we're not going to ever hear. Because I mean, the one good thing about the internet is these artists can get their music out there. They can create and have an outlet, and they don't need a record company or Rolling Stone magazine. Like we were just saying, like we did in the '70s.
Right.
So the good thing is you have your outlet, but the fact that they are not going to be able to make a living off of it and not be able to monetize it and somehow pay their bills, they're eventually going to probably just make it a hobby and have to go out and get a job at an office building somewhere. And
well, it's also
scary thing.
Yeah. Also, Mike, people are used to hearing things that are really high quality. They're used to hearing, you know, really great sounding records. I mean, if you want to compete, right? And that, I mean, that just costs a lot of money to do.
I don't think so. I mean, I know, When I was in Dream Theater all those years ago, we would you know, go to the big, expensive, you know, $1,000-$2,000 a day studios, and we'd lock it out for months on end, and we'd stay, put ourselves in hotels in Manhattan, and you know, I've joked with you before, and I've even said it, you know, we made one album, our Starbucks bill alone was like $30,000, you know, and honestly, that's in this day and age a waste of money. And I think that's, you know, it's sad that the big studios are closing because bands don't have those kind of budgets anymore. We don't have those kind of budgets anymore because nobody buys the music anymore. But I think the good news is you can make a great sounding record without having, you know, I think in modern day times, especially this past year, everybody's in lockdown. Even Paul McCartney just made his first lockdown album, you know,
right?
You know, with the Pro Tools, and yet you have all your gear in your house. So everybody this year was, you know, recording in their homes, and yep. I think a lot of these albums do sound actually really, really good. I think if you put, you know, for instance, Sola Gratia, your last solo album made completely in lockdown. I think sonically, if you play it side by side with Close to the Edge. Or let's pick up a close to the edge of the '70s, smaller budget, but let's say a big budget album of the '80s, you know, you could put it side by side and sonically, I think it's going to sound just as good and maybe in some cases even better. So I think
Gratia is still, I mean, just doing the bare minimum that I do, it's still more money than I could afford to pay if I didn't get any kind of advance or anything. It's still, you know, Rich, you know, God bless him, but Rich is not cheap.
You gotta pay him.
Jerry Giedros isn't cheap. The string players aren't, you know, everybody's got to get paid, you know. You've got to get paid something for, you know, you're not going to, you know, so it's still, I'm just saying.
Oh, good point, yeah.
If somebody is just some guy, you know, in his early 20s who doesn't have any money, who's like maybe making minimum wage already, like he's going to need some help.
Well, I think once again, I got to disagree because, and here's the perfect example. Billie Eilish last year, biggest album of the year, biggest star and breakthrough star of the year. I think she won something like 5 Grammys or whatever. She and her brother made that album in their bedroom.
In their bedroom, yeah.
They live at home with their parents still. And they probably cost them a couple thousand dollars maybe at the most to make that album. So it can be done.
It can obviously be done.
The albums we make, we are hiring, you know, string players and mixers and things like that, but you don't have to.
No, I mean, if you're somebody like the Boston dude, I mean, he made that whole record in his basement and then sold it. I mean, if you're a wizard with audio, you know, but I think those are the outliers. And what we're really going to miss out on is the bands that took 6 albums before they made their great one. Right. You must have some of those on as an example at the top of your head. I can't think of one. I mean, I think Gentle Giant is a band that didn't take that many albums, arguably, but I think they developed as they went along, you know, and that's a shame that or maybe I should put it this way. It was a great thing that at that time there was so much money in the business that labels could afford to just invest and stay with people for a long time.
Look at Pink Floyd. I mean, Pink Floyd's biggest selling album is Dark Side of the Moon, and that's, I think, their 5th or 6th album.
Is it really? I wouldn't even know.
Yeah. Well, you never even heard that album. But I think that was on the charts for like 1,000 weeks or whatever, and it sold how many zillions of records. But that's like their 6th album or something like that, you know?
Yeah.
There's a lot of bands that are on the... Or Rush, you know, Rush's biggest album was Moving Pictures. That was probably their 6th or 7th or 8th album.
I knew you'd have this. I knew you'd just... he's going to know this. Or, well, example, like the Bee Gees thing we watched.
Exactly.
You know, so they go into their slump. I mean, they would surely be dropped, and they were being considered to be dropped. But Robert Stigwood said, no, we're going to stay with it, you know?
Yeah. That was a fascinating documentary because they went through stages too. They had their late 60s, very kind of Beatles, Badfinger, you know.
Really? Did you hear
sound.
You heard Beatles in that? Did you?
Oh, I'd say I love those albums, those first 4 Bee Gees albums. But that they almost felt like they peaked, and then Robin leaves the band, and that could have been the end of it. Then they come back a few years later, then they had little Jive Talking and Nights on Broadway, kind of, okay, maybe, you know, they're back. But you could have thought, okay, maybe that's the end. And sure enough, by the time they hit Saturday Night Fever, you know, they hit the jackpot, and that's, you know, 10 years into their career at that point.
Yeah, because they had to develop the geek. What? That's what I used to call, that's what me and my friends used to call the guy. Like, he wasn't really one of those tan, handsome guys. They kept this little, like, emaciated albino guy in the corner.
A little gnome.
Right, in the corner of the room. Every once in a while, they, like, you know, put some, like, you know, pliers to his toes, and he would go, Yeah, it took a while to develop. They had to develop that. Well, they did. They did.
Yeah, totally.
It was funny when they talked about that, too, because I remember I really liked Nights on Broadway.
Yeah.
That was a Bee Gees song that I really loved the synth bass on it, you know, and I thought it was a good song and a good groove, and I remember the falsetto vamping at the end, and thinking, oh yeah, that's interesting, that's working. And then everything after that was all that.
Yeah, totally.
You know? And
totally.
So it was interesting talking about them sort of discovering this sound and all of that. So,
hey, you covered a Bee Gees song, man. We covered one of the obscure early 60s ones on the cover, one of the cover to cover albums.
And, Lemons.
And
right?
I just heard that Barry Gibb heard it and dug it because I connected with Barry's son, Stephen Gibb.
Really?
And, he told me that him and his dad loved our cover of Lemons Never Forget. So how cool is that?
Wow, that's really cool, man.
Yeah.
That's cool. Well, Mike, I got to ask you something maybe a little more serious.
Okay.
People ask me about your spirituality, Mike. I that's kind of a funny thing, right? So where's Mike at with God, they will say to me. And I'll say, well, I don't know. You should probably ask him.
Right.
But anyway, I don't want to make you uncomfortable or anything. We can edit out if you want.
I'm not uncomfortable.
Yeah, I just thought I should ask because I know people are interested.
Well, I'm not a practicing. I'm Jewish by birth. I mean, I was born into a Jewish family. Both of my parents are Jewish. But
how's the song go?
I'm a heavy metal, blue bearded, long haired tattooed Jew. I was born into it. I went to Hebrew school when I was a kid. I got kicked out of Hebrew school a few times, expelled.
What did you get expelled for, man? Come on.
Oh, just because I hated it, honestly. I was just a horrible, horrible student. I didn't want to, I had no interest in it, but I was kind of doing it to, keep my family happy.
Were they teaching you scriptures to memorize and stuff like that, or?
Oh, I don't remember. I didn't even pay attention. I was, I always jokingly say, I'm the world's worst Jew,
He said that in Israel, by the way. I remember. Yeah.
So, I went through that and I got bar mitzvahed when I was 13. But to be honest, when my mom passed away and my grandma passed away and then my dad passed away, they were the three influences that were kind of, keeping the Jewish traditions in my family. And to be honest, once the three of them were gone, I just never had a personal interest in religion, to be honest with you. So I'm, really a non-practicing Jew, just to put it that way. And then, to come back to, spirituality and obviously I work with you and you're so much of your lyrics and your music is so spiritually and based in that. But I'm not a Christian, but just to answer for the people out there, I don't practice anything, to be honest, but I respect it. I surely can. And plus also when I got sober, I went through, the step work and everything like that, which a big part of that is turning it over and believing in a higher power and, closing with the Lord's Prayer and all that kind of stuff. And I learned, I leaned on the Serenity Prayer so much, in early sobriety. So I believe in a higher power and spirituality. I'm just not a practicing Jew or Christian or Buddha or whatever. But I respect you and how important it is to you and also the other guys in the Neal Morse band. It's a big part of all of your lives and I respect that. And I think I'm a better person for being around it when I'm with you guys. I definitely feel like I'm a calmer, kinder person when I have that energy around me. And I always have to, when I'm with you, I have to be very, I watch my mouth. I have a New York trash mouth at times, but I try to not swear, and I try, it's a good calming, positive influence in my life when I'm around it with you and the other guys or, coming out to Morse Fest is always a very spiritual experience. It takes place in the church and most of the people coming are, very, very spiritual or religious. So, yeah, I really can respect it. I really do. And I see how good of an influence you and that has been on me. So I really do appreciate it.
That's awesome, man. Yeah, I remember I was in California. It was the fall after I had quit Spox in June. And the announcement, I believe, was made after the album came out in September, or maybe it was October. So it was around November. In September and October, I was getting all this flood of ideas that became the Testimony album. And so I was feeling like the Lord wanted me to continue to do music. I mean, that was how surrendered I was. I didn't really know if I was going to continue in music or what God was going to do with me and I was just ready for whatever he wanted to do. And I remember being taking a walk on the beach out there in California and praying about, well, who should I play with? Who should play on this album? Because it was clear by that time that there was an album. And I remember like feeling inside your name. And I said, oh, come on. No way. Not him.
Not a heavy metal, long-haired, what, a heavy metal, long-haired, blue-bearded, tattooed Jew playing on your testimony album? What?
I didn't really argue. For me, it was really more like, I don't think Mike's going to be into this, really, was how I was thinking. But I thought, well, I'll ask, you know, and cut ahead to when we were making the album, you were playing drums, and you know, it always amazed me how much you get it. Like, I didn't know anything really about where you were at spiritually or anything much at that time, but I'll never forget, you stood up your drum kit when I say, I waved goodbye to my past and walked into the kingdom. You stood up at the kit and said, this is the whole album right here. Jerry.
Jerry.
He makes a little megaphone with his hand.
Yeah, that's my little megaphone. Jerry.
Because he's afraid he won't be heard, you see. Got to make sure we're heard.
Yeah. Americans.
Us Americans. But yeah, I was like, wow, Mike really gets it. Because that is, of course, the pivotal statement,
right?
You know, is like, okay, I'm actually going to go this way, right?
Well, first of all, I appreciate you inviting me on the journey with you. Think about if we didn't continue from that point on, we would have pretty much made the two transatlantic albums together, and that would have been it. So, and now look at what we've done the 20 years since, you know, between Flying Colors and all of your albums and Neal Morse Band. And I mean, you know, it's an unparalleled body of work that we've done through the last 20 years or so. So I thank you for calling me and inviting me to join you on the journey. But as far as getting it, man, I mean, I was so moved by that album. And I remember the shows we did in support of that album being brought to tears so many nights on stage, and feeling the spirit and feeling the love and the energy, you know, so many points, not only on that tour, but in all the years that followed. You know, we've had so many of those moments where I was brought to tears by what is going on. And you could feel it when it's happening.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
So I thank you for having me on the journey with you.
Well, thank you, man. Wow, what a tremendous contribution on so many levels. But I remember you coming off stage, I think maybe at that, what's now become like a kind of, I don't know, a mountaintop event for me, that first testimony show at the Astoria in the basement of the Mean Fiddler, it was called.
Yep, I remember.
And I think you came off stage and said, what are you doing to me, man? What's going on? I was like, that's just God, because that was so powerful. It was the first time I ever gave my testimony about Jada to a non-church audience, you know. It's like, and I just felt the Lord's hand at my back, like, speak. And I was like, oh my God, you know, you don't know if they're going to throw stuff at you or, you know, it's a pretty risky thing. And, but obviously God was in it and touched the whole place. I know that for a fact, because, we had a service in London about 3 years later, and a guy came and gave his testimony about being there that night. And he came because of you. Wow. You know, a lot of people come because of you. Wow. You're probably aware of that, but
well, you know what, if I could use my powers for good, then that's a great thing, you know?
Oh yeah, it was great. And this guy's story really briefly was that he was about to leave his family, leave his church. He'd had enough with everything. He's just going to get in his car and keep on driving. And after the concert, he was so moved, he went back to his family and went back and, you know, and he was crying and it was, you know, so yeah.
That's what it's all about, man. You know?
Yeah. And we all know that it wasn't any of us that did it. You know, I know that it was just, it was God just working in that room. I was just responding, and I was willing, and I was scared, actually.
Well, I remember that was a very spontaneous moment too. You didn't warn us beforehand that we were in the middle of, I think, Ode to Feel Him, was it? And you just asked us to wait, and we brought it down, and you know, and then you gave that testimony about Jada there for the first time. That's the first time I had ever heard you talk about it openly, and it was just so powerful. It was incredible, really incredible.
Yeah, wow. And so, like you said, so many other amazing moments.
Well, to the point where you now have a tissue box mounted on your keyboard on stage.
That's right.
You know, it's not a good gig if Neil comes off stage and he hasn't cried.
Yeah. My granddaughter was in here recently, and she's like, "Opa," she calls me Opa. "Opa, why do you have this tissue box covered in black covered in black tape?" I said, "Well, so it won't show up on the cameras." Yeah, that's a fact. That's a fact.
Yeah.
Well, that seems like a good place to land, brother.
Yeah. I mean, we could do this all day. It'll be the longest podcast in history.
I haven't kept track of the time. What time is it? Oh, yeah, that's good.
Yeah,
that's good. Yeah,
you remember to hit record, right?
Yeah. I got it on Pro Tools too.
Oh, can we do that again? I'm sorry, we got to do the whole thing over again.
Yeah, right.
I've done a few interviews like that where you find out a few days later the publicist will say, "Hey, that journalist lost the tape or never hit record or is."
Oh, I know. Well, that's why I was so paranoid to do this last Morse Fest actually live, because I've seen the stop, nothing's working thing so many times. I just wanted to have a little bit of time to make things right.
What a great Morse Fest this was. It was so different. I mean, it was really strange to not have an audience. And we had a little bit of an audience, but it was very, very, very small. But it was just nice to play again. That's the only time I've played, on stage this whole year, since everything shut down. So it was really a blessing. And there were some powerful moments. The first night, the cover night, was so much fun. That was just about fun. And, getting a switch, I got to play bass for three songs. And, that was just the fun night. But then the second night was the real powerful, theatrical, emotional night. And you could, by the time we got to end of Sola Gratia on the second night, once again, you could feel it. And even with a very, very, very limited audience in the room, it was more than just us or the audience. There was something there.
Yeah.
And it was great to be able to do it and share it with people all around the world that maybe never were able to come to a Morse Fest. So yeah, it was a great, great, great experience.
Yeah. I'm amazed at how, with all the moving parts and all the things that could go wrong, how well it all came together. And
yeah.
Thanks for all that you do and all your help and for being such a good friend and for having this conversation with me today, man.
Oh, man. My pleasure, man. I love you, brother.
I love you too, man.
All right. Well, thanks for having me. Congratulations on your maiden voyage. And wait a second.
What?
Hang on.
What?
Merry Christmas, Neil. Merry Christmas.
Hey, there you go. There he is.
There we go.
There you go. There
Santa you go. Mike.
All right, man. Well, Merry Christmas and happy holidays to you and your family.
Same to you.
You guys have a great new year and all that. And
I hope to be seeing you soon, man.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, I will be seeing you soon.
You will. I didn't know if you wanted to divulge that information, but I'll be seeing you very soon.
Yes.
Have you been a good boy this year, Mr. Morse? I know you haven't been naughty. I know you've been nice, so I'll be coming to visit you soon.
I think so, sir. I think so. All right, man. You have a
good
one.
I don't look like Santa. I look like one of his elves, more like it, right? All right, my brother.
All right, yeah. You take care.
I love you, and I'll see you soon, man.
All right, take care, bro.
Bye-bye.
Bye.